Welcome to everyone. My name is Mick. I'm from Contour Education, and today we're going to look at collecting and representing sound data around the school and using geospatial technologies to do that. And this is part of an inquiry into whether our school meets the WHO guidelines for noise. So, is our school too noisy? Our task is to investigate ambient noise levels, and we're going to get into groups to do that and then plan our investigation. Students in Queensland will use an inquiry model. The senior syllabus documents all have fairly consistent approaches there, and we can spend some time planning that out and developing the data collection with our students. Once we're ready to collect the data, there are a couple of tools we'll need to do that, and in this instance, we had two groups and they collected data at two sites each. They used a decibel counter to do that on their mobile devices. There are a couple listed here in the presentation that you can access, and there's no cost for those. To actually collect the data, to enter the data into a table, the students used an app called EpiCollect 5, and each site required a new entry, and we'll have a look at EpiCollect in a moment. So the students were divided into groups and they had to collect data at a number of sites you can see there. They had to spend 30 seconds, I think it was, recording audio, and then the same amount of time with their data meters out, and then they had to select an average over that period to actually enter into their data. So let's now take a look at EpiCollect 5. EpiCollect 5 is a great data gathering tool, and you can get that app for Android and for Apple. The app is supported by an online, I guess, an online environment or portal where you can go and create, modify, change your what they call projects. So if we have a look at a project here. You can see we have a sound monitoring project which we set up in March. And if we go in and have a look at that, you can see here is the project details. So here is the actual form itself, and this is where you as the teacher would collect or set up the questions that your students would then be able to collect data from. There's a bank of question types on the left, and you can see it's just a matter of clicking and dragging each relevant question out and then filling in the information you'll need. I'll just delete that one, but you can see here, here's our four questions. So what is the site name? And that was a drop-down menu. Where was the data collected? This is a location question, and it automatically gets the latitude, longitude for you. This was a number, so what is the average noise level? And then a recording, and where they can add a recording. So that's the question, the sort of the details of the project. If we actually look at our project, we had four entries, and we can go and check the data out here. And you can see our students collected their data. You could see there were four separate entries, one for each site. The title is just a sort of generated kind of ID column by the it's auto-generated. We have the time or date when the data was collected. We have the site name from our drop-down. We have the location for the data. You can see in latitude, longitude using decimal degrees. And then we have the noise level itself. I actually added this record 20 seconds of audio after the students collected the data, so there's no audio there. In EpiCollect 5, you have an option to map the data, which is handy. So you can see it's popped the data on the map for me. And each site there, we get our a summary of all that data. You can actually edit the entry itself here as well, and you can go through each question and change it as required. We don't need to do that. So once we have our data in EpiCollect, our students have gone out and collected the data. They've recorded the audio, they've input the data into EpiCollect through their mobile device. The students, when they use the mobile device, will need to select this title as their as a kind of search function. So make that title descriptive, and that way your students can search it and find it easily. We're now getting into the data representation side, and here is where we will need to take our table and download that table from EpiCollect. And if I click download, which I already have, I can go ahead and collect my downloaded data. Here it is here, and you can see I've got an Excel spreadsheet, and that will have all of my data in it. Now I'm going to go into Google Maps to represent my data, and if I sign in, you can see I've signed into my Google Maps up here. I can go into this menu and go to Your Places, and I can move across to Maps, and down the very bottom I can create a map. So I'll do that, and the tool should open up Google My Maps, which is a separate tool to Google Maps, and it has a lot more functionality to actually create and edit and modify your own data. Now here we're going to firstly add a title. And we could put a whole stack of information here, weather conditions, any other relevant info could go in here. And our data was March 2020 for the record. Okay, so that information's been updated. In my map, I've got a few base maps I can use. So you can see there's the Google map, we've got satellite image, we've got a terrain map, which is really cool. It gives us a really nice 3D terrain effect. And there's a whole bunch of other base maps depending on the data that you want to represent. So we're going to import our data, and if I select a file from my device,
and go to my documents.
it should upload an Excel spreadsheet to which I've converted my data into a spreadsheet. You can see there's my spreadsheet. We can change these headings, but there's the site name, the latitude, the longitude, the other information, and then the average sound and our audio. So the first question the computer asks is where was the data located? And we're going to pick our latitude and our longitude. And then the title. We're going to use the site name as the title. So Google's having a think. It's going into our table. You can see it's grabbed the latitude and longitude and actually located the data accurately for me. It has only represented the location at this stage, and so we can change that by clicking here in the menu area and clicking on individual styles. And if we change that to style by data column, and the column we want is this number 3, what is the average sound level? From there, we can, rather than choosing categories, we want ranges of data. And you can even pick different colors, and maybe one less class. And so what that does, Google then, it's given me, for a higher number, it's given me a green color, and a lower number, a red. Now, when it comes to noise, we probably want to swap those around. So we can change the colors in the legend here by clicking that little paint tin and just adjusting that red to a green, and then adjusting that green to a red. And that gives us a bit more accuracy. So what we've been able to do now is represent our audio, our noise levels. You can see those lower level decibel levels, which are preferable for noise, are represented in green on the map. The medium level, 60 decibels, is represented in yellow, and the highest reading, 81 decibels, is represented in red. And as I say, you can shuffle your bass map according to what's going to look best for you. So there's a few options there. Maybe a satellite looks a bit cluttered. So yeah, I think that's our option. So back to our data. We've mapped our data. Oh, sorry, here we are. We've mapped our data. We've used Google My Maps to do that. And then we actually sort of have to use our information, have to analyze that data in some way. So is the noise level unsafe? What is the WHO recommendation? We can compare the two and see. And as it happens, the WHO recommendation is 85 decibels. So one of our sites comes close to that at 81 decibels, and that might be worth more evaluation. And finally, it's always worth inserting a reflection stage here. And we can have a look. Number one, how can we manage any unsafe noise levels? What can we do about it? But also we can reflect on our own study. So, you know, what factors might be affecting our data? Well, we only had one reading at each site. It was only over an average period of a very small period. So, you know, didn't really take traffic lights into account. So there's a few issues there. So that's all of our information. Hopefully you've seen how you can use geospatial tools to collect and represent data while in the field. We've looked at noise today, but you can hopefully see some applications a bit more broadly for things like, say, water quality data, vegetation studies, even stuff in humanities like surveys of local residents, that kind of thing. So thanks for listening. If you've got any questions, you can get in touch with me at Mick, M-I-C-K, at contoureducation.com. Thank you for listening, and I'll see you soon.